if Harley Quinn is going to be one of the good guys, or should I say good girls and birds of prey, who does that leave for the future of DCEU villains beyond our immediate future? I'm talking about the wave of movies after that, which is actually fast approaching. And that's Matt Reeves' The Batman and Gavin O'Connor's Suicide Squad 2. And I've got an update for you today regarding the villains in those two movies. So first up, Matt Reeves' The Batman. Now, we've heard a rumor for quite some time now that he's using the Penguin. And that rumor has been fueled by Josh Gad's aggressive campaigning for the role. And Josh Gad, I think, is right to campaign for that. He's a good fit visually, right? I think he could portray Oswald Cobblepot quite well, and he certainly has his fans, right? He would, and actually not a fan base that you think would usually go and see a DCEU movie. So it would broaden the appeal of the film. So I hope it's going well for Josh. Maybe he's already landed the role, because they are indeed using the Penguin. But the Penguin isn't the main villain in the movie. Instead, Reeves is going with the Court of Owls, which fits with Penguin in a movie. Because comic book writer Scott Snyder, who created the Court of Owls, set them up as consisting of Gotham's wealthiest and oldest families. If you watch Gotham on Fox, you already know this, and we're gonna touch on that for sure. While the Cobblepots haven't been part of the Court of Owls in the comics, they have been established in the comics as one of the first families of Gotham, the five families of Gotham, right? So the five families are the Wayne family, Batman's family, obviously, the Kane family, and Martha, Bruce Wayne's mother, was from that family. So when she and Thomas married, it brought two of the five families together. Side note, I prefer Jeff. I'm not a big Jeff Johns fan these days, as many of you know, but I do absolutely adore his Batman Earth 1, volumes 1 and 2, and he made Martha an Arkham, which put a little bit of crazy in Bruce Wayne, which would explain not only why he dresses up as a bat to fight crime, but also why he's locked in a dance with his rogues gallery, you know, shares that wonderful laugh with the Joker and the Killing Joke, instead of just permanently deals with them. So I really like that. But anyway, in the comics, his mother is a Kane. And also his cousin, Kate Kane, aka Batwoman, also hails from that family. And then there's the Dumas family, which was used a lot in the Gotham television show. The Cobblepot family, Penguin's family. And then also the Elliot family, which eventually led to Tommy Elliot, aka Hush. Now, Reeves has set his film as a prequel 15 years in the past before Robin. So we're not going to have the Bat family in this film as many of us had hoped. Now, the Court of Owls has a lot of fans in the comic book world, and many have been pushing for Matt Reeves to use them. Maybe he heard their call and was like, oh, the Court of Owls is cool. Look at that cool image from, it was like a couple of comic book conventions ago, and everyone got a Court of Owls mask. And it was a cool visual. But while it was a cool visual, at the convention, you know, in a still frame, I don't know how much visual flair the Court of Owls has overall. I think they were a good fit for a television show like Gotham. And that's another thing. Gotham has already explored these characters, so it wouldn't even be something new that Matt Reeves would be able to introduce to mainstream audiences. Although you could argue that maybe he would, because Gotham's ratings are medium. Okay. Gotham also even used the Talons, undead soldiers that execute the court's directive when brute force or assassination is necessary, but they did definitely the cheap version of the Talons. The Talons in the comics look a lot cooler, and a movie would be able to accurately bring them to life. But overall, I just think there are more cinematic Batman villains, and I'm not sure if a Court of Owls Penguin, you know, Court of Owls movie with the side of Penguin will check the boxes that mainstream audiences have come to expect a Batman movie to check. I mean, while Nolan's Batman films were very cerebral and austere, and Matt Reeves might be working off of those creative choices, let's remember that Nolan's most successful film featured the Joker. It could work. If it has amazing writing, amazing cinematography, and amazing action sequences with those Talons, and, you know, it has some interesting mystery about the history of Gotham, you could see that being pretty cool. And Matt Reeves delivered some excellent action sequences, particularly in his last Apes movie. So I'm not saying it wouldn't definitely wouldn't work, but I think it's riskier perhaps than it needs to be. Now let's move on to Suicide Squad 2, which actually has some really good options, right? But that doesn't seem they're taking any of them. So remember the squad, remember that story from a while back, they were going to be ordered to take down a weapon of mass destruction, right? That was going to turn out to be, surprise, Black Adam. Well, not a surprise, Dwayne Johnson was too busy to do that. Well, I think more accurately, too busy not to star in the movie. So that leaves Gavin O'Connor, who had his little girl, Save a Little Girl storyline, stolen by Margot Robbie for her Birds of Prey movie. So now he's back to this, and he's just trying to figure out who to use, and he as the weapon of mass destruction. And he and Warner Brothers are having a hard time deciding. So this is who I've heard they've shuffled through so far. Zatanna, Raven, and even, oh, I love this idea, Kara Zor-El, but not as Supergirl. These are such good ideas. I like all of them. Now, the first two, I can see them being disqualified because they're too much like Enchantress. Zatanna has the magic angle, and Raven has, you know, her powers could come across as magic, and of course, the demonic aspects. So it's too much like Enchantress because the storyline's already like Enchantress. Take down a living weapon. It was Enchantress the first time around. Who is it this time? But Kara... Well, everyone's been saying, and it's been hinted at, even by Zack Snyder and his team, that she was the one in the open pod for Man of Steel. Remember that? But nobody ever confirmed it for sure. So wouldn't it be cool if she did escape from that pod? What happened to her? Maybe she was taken by some, evil force, right? And maybe a rogue government, right? Or another villain, and had been turned into a living weapon. That would be a really cool storyline, and it would help to start create connections between these movies, which I think the DCEU has been slow to do. Really strong ones like this. The squad could even rescue her, just like they were supposed to, I think, rescue, you know, they were going to rescue a little girl, whether it was Cassandra Cain or not. You know, I don't know if that's what Gavin O'Connor himself came up with, but they could save Kara, and that would get them some points from Superman, and you have Superman cameo in the movie. Or even cooler, Amanda Waller's like, I'm going to keep Kara as an ace up my own sleeve, and then Supes comes knocking, not in a friendly way. That would be fantastic, right? And then Suicide Squad versus the League. That's when the Suicide Squad, I think, really, this version of it, you know, that what they've turned it into over at DC, really excels. But they're not doing any of that, all right? So what they've settled on is Amazo. Now, Amazo, for those of you who aren't familiar with the character, is an old Justice League enemy. He's basically like a Super Skrull over from Marvel. He's an android who can duplicate the powers of whoever he comes up against. So just like the Super Skrulls have all the powers of the Fantastic Four, Amazo, after he fought the League, took on all their powers. But if he fights Suicide Squad, they don't really have any powers. So, I don't think he would just like mimic their personalities. That'd be crazy. So I hope that's not his first fight. I hope he's already come into contact with the League and has their powers. And then knowing Waller, I wouldn't be surprised if this was not a stop mission, but an acquisition mission. Or maybe she's testing her own android, although how many times is she gonna get one over on the League? That would also be copying the first movie perhaps too much, but we'll see. What do you think of these villain choices for both films? Do either excite you? Do you think either is a mistake? And if you were, by the way, Gavin O'Connor, you know, he could still change his mind, right? DC changes, you know, hey, Frozen was reworked at the very last minute. It turned out great. Who would you advise him to pick as the living weapon? Write your thoughts down below. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.